Morning, Chair Dyak.
Good morning. How are you, Mr. Pabst?
I'm doing well.
Good.
Melinda had been checking on quorum, and as of yesterday afternoon, looked like we were gonna not have a problem getting quorum, but waiting for a few people to get signed on there.
Yeah.
So, Melinda and Chair Dyak, when do you want to get things rolling here?
Melinda, how's it looking on your end?
I am doing a count now. Unfortunately, Jeff Coleman told me that he was having some difficulties, so I'm trying to help him out as well. Okay. Let me see where we're at. Oh, Jeff is now on, so he's good. Let's see. I think we need one more for quorum.
Did you count me, Melinda? Because I'm an alternate for Dr. Cog, too.
Yes, I did count you.
Okay. Be a little weird to vote on my own item, though.
Okay, we currently have exactly 12.
Okay.
All right, let's give it a go. I like to, it is 8:32 a.m. I'd like to call to order the Tuesday, April 14th Regional Transportation committee meeting. As a reminder, for the agenda item question comments, please use the raise hand button to indicate you have a question or would like to speak. Once it is your turn, staff will unmute your microphone and call on you to speak. Please make sure you are also unmuted on your end. If you have any technical questions, you can direct those to staff in the question box. Again, please use the raise hand function to ask any questions related to the agenda items. Roll call at this time, Melinda will ask all attendees. If for some reason you do not hear your name, we will unmute everyone at the end and you can state your name for the record. If you have any other difficulties, please email Melinda at mstevens, M-S-T-E-V-E-N-S, at drcog.org so she can add your name for the record. Next item, public comment. We will now open the meeting for public comment. The chair requests there be no public comment on issues for which a prior public hearing has been held before the board of directors. We will now unmute all participants of the meeting. If you have joined by computer, please raise your hand by pressing the raise hand button and we will call on you to begin speaking. If you have joined, please by phone, please unmute yourself by pressing star six on your phone. We will have you will have three minutes to speak, after which you will ask we will ask to wrap up and your line will be muted. Melinda, please unmute all participants at this time.
Hey, it looks like it seems like I'm having technical difficulties unmuting everyone. Emily, are you able to?
Let me try. Yeah, I don't believe I can.
Okay.
This is Bill Van Meter. Did I unmute myself?
Yes, you did. And I see that Mayor Stolzman also did. She also has her hand raised. Mayor Stolzman, do you have something you'd like to say?
I was just going to say we could ask the members of the public that care to comment to just raise their hand and they could unmute themselves.
Okay.
This is Kate Williams with RTV. We appear to be unmuted now.
This is Angie Rivera Malpietti with RTD. I am also unmuted now.
Perfect. Wynn Shaw also unmuted.
This is Doug Tisdale here, and Doug Tisdale is now unmuted. Thank you.
Jeff Coleman, unmuted.
Mike Silverstein.
Okay. Okay. Chair Dyack, do we want to see, do you want to ask again for public comment now that we have everyone unmuted? Let's see. Chair Dyack, you can speak now.
Great, thank you. All right, anyone for public comment at this time, please use the raise hand tool and we will get to you. Okay, Melinda, I assume there is no one?
I'm not seeing anything on our end, and everyone should have the ability to be unmuted and also unmute themselves individually. So I would assume at this point that we have no one.
Great, thank you so much. On to the action items. No, I'm sorry. On to the February 18th RTC meeting summary. Is there any discussion or questions about the February 18th RTC meeting? Please use the raise hand button to indicate that you have a question or would like to speak. Once it is your turn, staff will unmute your microphone and call on you to speak. Please make sure you are also unmuted on your end. Maluna, are there any hands raised at this time?
I don't see any hands yet, but obviously I'll give everyone just a few moments to raise their hand if they'd like to. All right. At this point, Chair Dyack, it looks like we do not have any hands raised.
Great. If there is none, I would like for someone to approve the minutes and move on to the next item. Is there a motion to approve the minutes? Linda, do you see a hand raised?
I do. It looks like we have one from Wynn Shaw. Wynn, you are able to speak.
Thank you. I move to approve the meeting minutes from February 18th.
Thank you.
Seconds.
Thank you. We have a motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Yep.
Aye.
All right.
Aye.
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 Against? Abstain? Motion carries. Okay. On to the action items. The first item is discussion on return community mobility plan and implementation set aside of the 2020 and 2023 transportation improvement program funding to projects. Each presenter will have the ability to present their item, and with Melinda, entertain questions. I will then get the chair back so we can identify the motion and the second. So with that, Mr. Webb, please.
All right, thank you, Mr. Chair. Good morning, everyone. My name is Derek Webb. I'm a planner at Dr. Cog. As the chair just mentioned, I'm here to briefly discuss a recommendation affecting the community mobility planning implementation set aside due to a funding award that has been declined. Just for some quick background, since it's been a little bit since we've talked about this, you may recall having the CMPI project funding discussion back in October of 2019. At that time, that discussion recommended approval of 16 projects, both kind of a mixture of small infrastructure and planning projects to the board of directors. Ultimately, those projects were approved. They were approved by the board, and award notice was sent to each sponsor in late October. Just want to make clear, as you can see from the memo item today, the discussion today really only focuses on the small infrastructure side of the set aside. Nothing is changing on the planning side. So to fast forward to December 2019, Dr. Cog's staff was notified by the city of Centennial that they were declining the funding that had been awarded previously in October. With $300,000 back in the set aside, Dr. Cog's staff reconvened and consulted with the original project review panel, really to develop a new recommendation, the recommendation you see before you today in your packet. To reiterate what's in that memo item, staff recommends fully funding the city of Thornton Trail Wayfinding Signage Project. By adding $52,996. This project was originally only awarded a partial amount of funding in the original funding award back in October. Additionally, staff recommends using the remaining $247,004 to partially fund the City and County of Denver's Mobility Choice Network project. This project was the next project on the list of high-scoring small infrastructure projects, so it made sense to move down the list in such a way. Lastly, again, just to reiterate, there are no recommended changes for the funding of the planning projects. This is really just about these the Thornton project and the Denver project in the small infrastructure side of this set aside. That's really all I have. So I'm happy to stand for any questions you may have. Let me know. Thanks.
Okay, Derek, this is Melinda. We're just gonna give everyone a second to have the opportunity to raise their hand in case they have any questions or comments they'd like to make.
Sounds good.
Okay, Okay, it looks like our first question is from Ashley Stolzman. Mayor Stolzman, you have the ability to speak.
Motion to approve.
Okay.
We have a motion from Director Stolzman. Is there a second?
It looks like we have a second from, I can't tell exactly who it is. So Nicole Carey, it looks like you're signed in twice, for, I know, for two different representatives. I guess whoever wants to make the motion, you can go ahead and unmute yourself.
Director Buzek, RTD, second.
Thank you, Director Buzek. Melinda, once again, could you please please open up the line so we can get a voice vote?
Yep, everyone should be unmuted. If you're self-muted at this point, you would need, oh, let me see, hold on. It says, sorry, one moment.
Sure.
For some reason, it's having issues unmuting everyone at once. Let's see. Emily, are you seeing on your end why it's doing that?
It's unmuted now for us.
Yeah, it should be unmuted.
Great.
Okay, so I guess everyone would need to unmute themselves at this time.
Great.
I vote aye in favor of the motion.
All right, yeah. All in favor, aye.
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 Yep.
Aye.
All right.
Aye.
Against? Abstain? Motion carries. Thank you, everybody. Next item, discussion of urban arterial multimodal safety improvements program and eligibility rules and selection process. Mr. Papsdorf. And again, same rules will apply. Mr. Papsdorf, Melinda will we'll take us through the questions and turn it back over for a motion and a voice vote. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Good morning, everyone. We've talked about this a couple of times. We're bringing forward the Urban Arterial Multimodal Safety Improvements Program approval and criteria. As you'll recall, we had originally anticipated bringing forward the actual approval to create the program last month, and due to the beginning of social distancing as a result of response to COVID-19, we canceled that RTC meeting. So this morning we're bringing forward both actions to both create the program and approve and ask for your approval of the eligibility criteria and selection process for this program. I will want to note that we've been working really diligently with CDOT staff to develop the criteria and selection process for your review and recommendation this morning. We also know that there's a lot of uncertainty right now as a result of COVID-19. And so we did want to bring forward this, this proposal and seek your approval this morning, even though we know that as we all review sort of the fiscal impacts of the response to COVID-19, things will likely change. In fact, as I get into my presentation later, I'll speak to sort of the schedule and the a little bit of uncertainty. We had originally anticipated opening the call for projects this month, and that will be delayed at least a month into May, and depending on circumstances may delay further. But we did think it was important to at least bring this forward to you now. So as a reminder, this action is really rooted in the work that we've been doing developing the Regional Vision Zero plan, as well as CDOT's focus on safety as well. As a reminder, in 2017, 266 people were killed in crashes on Denver region streets and highways. There have been 8,700 crashes in the 5 years between 2013 and 2017 that resulted in either a fatality or serious injury. And 1,149 people died on Denver regional roadways during that same five-year period. So we really see this effort as an important step forward in addressing those issues jointly between CDOT and Dr. Cog to support projects that will improve safety around the region, particularly for vulnerable users of the system that are disproportionately represented in those fatal crashes, particularly pedestrians and bicyclists. So you'll recall from our previous conversations, there are several different potential funding sources for this program. Previous allocations that CDOT and the Transportation Commission have made from Senate Bill 267 funds for the Region 1 portion of Dr. Cog, $25 million for urban arterial safety improvements, $26 million for arterial street, pre-BRT, BRT transit elements for a total of $51 million. We also have received to the state of Colorado a $37 million supplemental apportionment of surface transportation block grant federal funds. That distribution of that $37 million includes $9 million that would traditionally be directed by Dr. Cog, $3 million to the other metropolitan planning organizations around the state, $7 million for small urban and rural areas around the state, and then $17 million that CDOT would have available to invest anywhere in the state. So the proposal that we've been discussing now for several months is the opportunity to leverage that $9 million of unanticipated Dr. Cog directed surface transportation block grant funds with the $17 million of SDBG funds that CDOT has available to invest anywhere in the state to create a new $26 million urban arterial safety improvement set-aside program that really does create an opportunity to focus investments to address safety and mobility needs with a focus on those locations with the highest injury and crash rates. An opportunity to leverage the Dr. Cog directed SDBG funds with the state directed SDBG funds. And as a reminder, by creating this program, the funds would not be targeted by regional, sub-regional share. This would really be focused on regional high priority safety improvements. This action on the Dr. Cog side does require an exception to our adopted 2020 to 23 TIP waiting list protocol that we've talked about before. The program goals continue to be to reduce fatal and serious injury crashes, to support transportation system that safely accommodates all modes of travel, to improve transit access and multimodal mobility, to support the development of connected urban and employment centers and multimodal corridors around the region, and to provide safe access to opportunity and mobility. So transitioning a little bit to the criterion selection process, the three funding categories, again, are the Senate Bill 267 funds that the commission has previously allocated for Region 1, and the $26 million of surface transportation block grant funds. The Senate Bill 267 funds, because they were allocated just to Region 1, they would only be available for projects located within the Region 1 portion of Dr. Cog, which does not include Boulder County or Southwest Weld County. The surface transportation block grant funds, however, would be available for projects located within the entire Dr. Cog MPO boundary. So that does give us an opportunity to focus on safety improvements within Boulder County and the Southwest Weld County portions of Dr. Cog. The Senate Bill 267 funds are limited to projects located on state highways. That's because those were state funds directed by the legislature. To CDOT, and then the surface transportation block grant funds, we are proposing, in order to really be able to focus on the highest priority safety needs around the region, to allow funding for projects on any federal aid eligible roadway around the region. So not limited just to arterials, as is typical for our major transportation improvement program calls, but basically for any federal aid eligible roadway around the region, which are primarily collector and arterial facilities and above around the region. And we'll have maps available for those as the application process opens up. The funding requirements that CDOT and Dr. Cog are proposing are because of some of the funding limitations of the Senate Bill 267 funds, that all projects have to be able to be completed and submit all billings no later than June 1st of 2024. So readiness is an important consideration. That applicants may specify a preference for state-only funds from 267, from Senate Bill 267, or on those state highways. But at this point, CDOT and Dr. Cog can't guarantee that we will be able to allocate a specific funding source for a particular project. But we do want to hear from applicants about their preference, if they do have a preference for state-only funds for their project. We are proposing a minimum grant request of $250,000 per project and a maximum grant request of $15 million per project. And there would be a minimum local match requirement of 20%, regardless of whether the project is funded with state funds or federal surface transportation block grant funds. On the proposed evaluation criteria, we've identified five categories of priorities that would be scored and weighted. So safety obviously is the key priority here. So really looking at the extent to which the project proposal addresses safety need, especially those located on the high injury network that we've developed as part of the Vision Zero plan. And then enhanced mobility, for particularly for vulnerable users, and transit improvements around the region, likewise an important consideration. There's a category of other considerations that include things like the degree to which the project includes particular innovation or technology solutions, the potential for a state highway to be devolved to local control, and benefit cost. And those other considerations would be weighted a total of 10%. Public support and local match are important, so the extent to which the applicant demonstrates that there is public support and commitment to local match. And then, as I said earlier, readiness is particularly important and is weighted at 20%. This process I'll describe is what's being proposed. Note, however, though, since this presentation was put together, the dates are not going to be these dates, but the selection process will start with applications coming in to CDOT Region 1. We will convene a scoring and selection panel made up of staff from CDOT Region 1, as well as the Division of Transit and Rail, Dr. Cog and RTD represented on that panel. That panel will initially review all of the eligible applications that come in, create scoring. We will then convene an advisory committee that has two CDOT staff and one representative from each of the eight Dr. Cog county subregions to review the scoring and to develop a funding recommendation of those projects. That recommendation then will go back to that scoring and selection panel to review the advisory committee recommendations and make a final recommendation to the decision-making bodies, the Dr. Cog committees, TAC, RTC, and board, and the CDOT Transportation Commission. So with that, we do have a recommended motion before you this morning to move to recommend to the Board of Directors the exception to the waitlist protocol in order to create this program, as well as approval of the eligibility rules and selection process for the program. With that, I'd be happy to take any questions. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Linda, do we have anybody who's raising their hand?
I see our first hand raised. It looks like it's coming from Ashley Stolzman. Mayor Stolzman, if you want to go ahead and unmute yourself, you have the ability to speak.
Thank you. So thank you, Mr. Papstor, for the great presentation. I'm supportive of the program. I do want to make a couple of comments, though, about some proposed changes I'd like to make this morning. So, it's a very unprecedented time, and I recognize that this process, it seems like it's a reasonable thing to delay accepting applications, but I actually believe we should not delay This is a time where we need to open all the faucets that we can for funding sources. And so to hold any money that we have in the bank for a year or two, I think it's the wrong move. So I think we need to discuss what ways we can to get this money into the communities faster. And there are a number of reasons for that. You know, first, communities are spending money to address COVID-19 in a way that we all didn't budget for. Denver just, you know, they send a note every morning. They've spent over $15 million on response supplies, things like that. And none of that was budgeted for. My community spending money, all of our communities, all of our agencies are spending money to try to address the pandemic, which is appropriate. So this money is much needed transportation funding that we need to get into the communities. And so I have proposed to several of the congressional delegation in our area that they consider suspending the rules for 2 years on federal funding so that people can apply to have reimbursement on projects that are already out to bid or underway. This is unusual and not customary. I understand that, but it's a very unique time, and I think we need to think of creative solutions to try to address the crisis that we're all faced with. So just like I think the federal government should continue consider waiving their rules to allow reimbursement of projects, I think state funding should do the same and follow suit. And so I would encourage my colleagues who are on the call from CDOT to consider, you know, there are some really excellent projects in Region 1 and Region 4 that are either out to bid now or are going out to bid soon or maybe are underway that would compete well for these funds. And people should be able to apply with those projects and seek reimbursement. If we don't allow reimbursement, what it means is, let's say we did just stick with the 20th for the opening the call for projects. That would mean that someone can't bid their project if they were awarded until maybe around September, and that's an optimistic time estimate given the review. You know, application period has to be open, then the review panel has to look at it, then it has to go to committee, then it has to go to the other committee, then it has to go to the other committee. So at best, you'd be able to bid your project in September, and we know that most of the road projects are quite seasonal in nature. So optimistically, you might be able to get your construction started in May of next year. Whereas if you have a project to bid right now, you might be considering pulling that bid back, except that if you might be able to get this funding, you might keep it out there. And that's good for keeping people employed when so much unemployment is happening right now. It's very good to try to stimulate the economy in our area and to not sit on these dollars. The other reason I just want to bring up is that, you know, some people have said, well, pricing could be very good in a recession. And I would just like to caution folks that we also could enter a period of hyperinflation, and having money in the bank will do us no good if hyperinflation occurs with the type of money that's being printed right now at the federal level. And it is speculative to know what'll happen in the future, but it does seem quite risky to just hold cash in the bank. So I'm supportive of the program today. I can move it forward, but I would encourage us to consider ways to get the funding to communities faster, even if it means we have to do things outside of our normal processes or set special rules for this period of time. I think we should do that. And even if it means, you know, maybe we all say, okay, we're going to recognize this isn't normally what we would do, but we could pick one or two major projects that are underway, like I-70 or, you know, 270 or Parker Road or 225, whatever. Big projects, and we could allocate the funding to that. I think it's a big mistake to just sit on the funding for a couple of years. Thank you.
Thank you, Director Stoltzman. I guess I would, one, as part of the response, my understanding from CDOT is that the Transportation Commission is not planning on considering the allocation of the CDOT controlled surface transportation block grant funds until their May meeting. Could someone from CDOT confirm that for me?
Hey, Ron, this is Paul Jasaitis. Yes, that is true. We're, you know, I think it's important to note that we're not holding any money at this point. The whole goal of this program was to put a good notice of funding opportunity out on the street and see what the different local jurisdictions could come back with in terms of how do we find good, meaningful projects to reduce fatalities and injuries on the high injury network and on the state highway system. And so I think the process will go smoothly, and our intent is to get those projects selected as soon as we can and get them out on the street. So I hope that helps.
Director Pathsdorf, could you clarify whether Dr. Cog is or is not holding money already?
Director Stolzman, this money, holding this money, no. The $9 million of supplemental apportionment, I don't believe has hit our checkbook yet from CDOT, although that can happen in a matter of time. I think the discussions that I've been having with Executive Director Rex are that, you know, it makes sense to us to give CDOT the extra month to take this decision to the Transportation Commission on the SDBG funds for their portion of this action, because this truly is a joint action. And that, you know, that gives CDOT and all of us a little bit better chance to really determine what the implications are of and the impacts of the response to COVID-19 are on all of our funding situations and how we might want to proceed. Our thought is that if CDOT decides in May that either they're still not ready or that they are not in position to contribute the $17 million of statewide surface transportation block grant funds to this program, that our intent would be to reverse this decision and allocate the $9 million of Dr. Cog directed SDBG funds to our waitlist protocol so that we can get already approved projects out the door.
Okay, it looks like we do have another question or comment from Rebecca White. Rebecca, you should be able to unmute yourself and speak now.
Okay, thanks. Good morning, everyone. Rebecca White with CDOT. I think Ron primarily touched on what I was just going to add. You know, Mayor Stolzman, I think CDOT's in agreement with you philosophically that transportation investments really play an important part in economic recovery. We have, however, taken a month pause on this decision, mostly because we need to spend some time with our commission, better understanding and talking with them the some of the financial numbers we're seeing come in from the impact to our state. And so while we're very strongly, I think, in support of this program, we just need a bit more time to see where our budget is headed and be able to brief our commissioners. That's all I wanted to add.
Okay, thank you, Rebecca. Mayor Stolzman, it looks like your hand is still raised. You can unmute your, oh, looks like we're good. Okay,
at no, this no, time. No, I did have another comment. So I guess with those additional comments, I guess I'm not supportive of the program with the additional new information. You know, having CDOT not being sure if they want to proceed with the program, I think puts Dr. Cog in a waiting position that we should not be in right now. And so I think we should not waive our TIP waiting protocol. And I think we should just grant our surface block grant to the TIP waiting list to the subregional areas. I think waiting for CDOT to decide that they're not going to move forward on this is just a waste of time.
Okay, thank you for your comments, Mayor Stolzman. At this time, I do not see any more hands raised, so I will turn it back over to Chair Dyack.
Great, thank you, everybody. Obviously, quite a robust conversation in the short amount of time. One thing that maybe I see in this project is the ability to be collaborative with other partners, Dr. Cog wise looking. And the ability to leverage money to create greater amounts of money that we can access. So with that, I'm supportive of the program. And I will call for, with no more questions, I will call for a potential motion and a second. So with that, Melinda, can you look for the hand raisers to propose a motion and a second, please?
Absolutely. I'll give everyone the opportunity to raise their hand. Okay. Looks like I'm seeing one. I'm not sure if it's Don Stanton or Ms. Rivera Malpede, but either one of you, if you'd like to unmute yourself and make the motion.
I'm not sure whether you're seeing Nicole Carey as Doug Dill or not, and I apologize for the confusion that is created by the way we send these notices around, but it is Doug Tisdale. And respecting and understanding the concerns raised by the mayor, I do have a concern that this needs to have some additional thought. That said, I believe that the way to create that opportunity is to move forward at this time and to allow staff and interested parties to address it. Therefore, I would move to recommend to the Board of Directors the one-time exception as listed in the recommendation in our materials concerning the 2020-2023 TIP waiting list protocol. Thank you.
Great. Thank you, Director Tisdale, for the motion. Linda, do we have a hand raised for a second, please?
It looks like we do, by Wynne Shaw. Wynne, you can go ahead and speak.
Thank you. I would second that motion.
Great. Thank you, Director Shaw. With a motion and a second, Melinda, can you unmute everyone so we can do a voice vote, please?
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
If I may, this is Doug Rex with Dr. Cog. I just wanted to make sure and clarify that the motion that's on the table is not just for the actual waiting list variants, but also for the criteria as well. On the screen, basically.
Thank you. Thank you, Director Wright.
Chair, this is Karen Stewart. Can you hear me?
I sure can, Director Stewart.
Thank you. I'm not able to raise my hand, but before we take the vote, I wanted to add one thing as commissioner from CDOT, and that is that CDOT is taking the time to look at this because of the incredible burden that we may have on finances once we find out how much money is actually coming into our program. The advantage to having a partner in CDOT is that we were bringing more money to the table to make this a more robust program. And I suspect that CDOT commissioners will still go forward with this. But since I don't have a crystal ball, I can't guarantee that. And I think there's an advantage to moving this forward with the anticipation that CDOT will be part of this partnership once we know what our finances are going to look like in the next few years. So I appreciate having that opportunity to say that.
All right. Thank you, Ms. Stewart. Are there any additional comments before we go to the voice vote, please?
Well, this is Don Stanton, and I also want to second what Karen Stewart said. I think all of us on the commission will take a very close look. This had been briefed before, and I think there's at least a positive move going in. I'd also like to remind everybody that in our Denver region, our safety statistics before COVID were not looking good, and that there is a need to move forward, as Paul Jositis said, to do everything we can on these arterials. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Stanton.
Yes, sir. Ms. Doug Rex again. I do want to want to clarify to make sure that the motion and the second was for the full staff recommended motion that's on the screen. I think we need to make sure that the motion and seconder are fine with that.
All right, Director Tisdale.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Yes, that was the reason that rather than read it in full, I simply said for the recommendation as set forth in the materials. I'm looking at it on the screen now. And I believe that accomplishes what Executive Director Rex is talking about. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Director Tisdale. Director Shaw, are you okay with that?
Yes, that was my intention as well, so that we would be ready and can proceed in the interim. So my second stands.
I appreciate that. Executive Director Rex, any questions on the clarified motion?
No, sir. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Chair Dyack, it looks like Mayor Stolzman would like to make another comment. Her hand is raised. Mayor Stolzman?
Thank you. I really appreciate all the deliberation and the additional comments and perspective. I just would like to explain that I'm voting against the motion this morning. I understand that people feel like they're trying to move this forward to give us the most options. I think this is a time that we need to be direct and deliberate. And sometimes you have to take deliberate and concrete action in times like this. And I see this movement forward as a delay. It's at least a multiple month delay, if not a year delay in getting Dr. Cog funding out. And I am very much in favor ahead of COVID-19. I think this was a great way to leverage money between CDOT and Dr. Cog. But with the additional comments from my colleagues over at CDOT, I actually think there's I unfortunately think there's a very low chance of this moving forward. And that's where my no vote's coming from. I'm glad to hear your optimism. And in a couple of months, I'll buy you a cup of coffee if you're right, and you can buy me a cup of coffee if I'm right.
Right. Chair Dyack, we do have a few more hands raised. I think that they would like to make a comment as well. It looks like we have Don Stanton. Don, you can speak.
I already made my comment. Thank you.
Okay, sorry about that. And then Karen Stewart, did you have anything else you'd like to add, or is your hand just still raised?
No, thank you. My hand is going. It says it's red on my end, but I don't have anything more. Thank you.
Okay. All right. And then at this point, it looks like we don't have any more hands raised. So I'll turn it back to you, Chair Dyack.
Great. Thank you, Melinda. Okay. So we have a motion and a second. I will, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Okay, and then we have nay.
No.
Any abstentions? All right, with one nay and everyone else being aye, the motion passes. Thank you.
Chairman.
Yeah, Executive Director Rex, yes.
Sure, thank you very much. I just wanted for the sake of the record, I want to make sure that we have that the name of the person with the no vote.
Yes, I'm sorry.
Vice Chair Stolzman.
Thank you, Mayor.
There you go. All right.
Isn't that the first time there wasn't a unanimous vote at RTC? Because we can document that too.
No, there's been plenty.
All right. Next item, discussion of the draft eligibility rules and selection process for the RTO and T set aside. Mr. Cook.
Okay, good morning. This is Steve Cook, manager of modeling and operations with Dr. Cog. And this is an item here also to get approval of the eligibility rules and selection process for another one of our TIP set aside programs. And this is the Regional Transportation Operations and Technology program set aside. And this is attachment D of your agenda packet. I think it's page 34 of the agenda. Okay. Let's go on to the next. There we go. All right. As mentioned, this is part of the TIP, the Transportation Improvement Program that was adopted last year for the 2020 through 2023 period. In that TIP, the board allocated $5 million per year to this set-aside program. Some projects were selected a couple years ago and already programmed in the early years of this, of 2018 through 2021. So approximately $13 million, probably a little bit more, remains for allocation during this year's call for projects. And this is a multimodal technology program. It's roads, it's RTD transit type technologies, bicycle detection. So it truly is a multimodal program that's been going on for many years in the Dr. Cog region. A key part of this is that everything is interrelated from the technology and daily operations standpoint of transportation. You know, it's transit services, it's our arterial streets, freeways, tolling facilities, express lanes, maintenance and construction activities. You know, all of these things eventually lead towards major concerns with public safety. We want to get regional traveler information out there. On the far left there, another key thing is the regional data management of both real-time data and information, and also planning type information for analyzing past events. And then another key thing that you'll hear a lot about is at the top there is the situational awareness. We want our transportation operators to know what's going on out there, you know, real time. It's extremely important. So for this call for projects in 2020, what's unique is we're also working very closely with the AMP, or the Advanced Mobility Partnership. As you may recall, that group kind of came out of an offshoot of the Mobility Choice Blueprint, which was produced last year. And the AMP is assisting our Regional Transportation Operations Working Group by helping in, they helped out in the identification of some of the foundational system and infrastructure priorities, other types of project type priorities, and really encouraging the compatibility, collaboration, and the interoperability of all of these transportation technology systems. Another graphic to kind of show the relationships here, which is in your packet, is how the AMP has two components to it. They have their executive committee, which meets quarterly, and they've met a couple times already. And then there's also their AMP working group, which meets monthly. And especially the AMP working group has worked very closely in terms of providing advice and guidance to the RTO, the Regional Transportation Operations Working Group. Now that RTO working group, that's really all of your agencies and local governments. That's your staff who's really the boots on the ground in terms of transportation technology operations. You know, they're the ones that are installing devices, monitoring traffic or transit conditions, and they've been meeting as a group for nearly 30 years. So I think this is really great this year that we have kind of this combination of both the technical boots on the ground people, along with the more policy guidance type folks with the AMP. So between those two groups, they identified some of the key project priorities for this call for projects, dealing with extension of traffic signal systems on our key regional corridors, more advanced traffic signal systems, performance monitoring and measuring, travel time monitoring, regional data sharing is very important, and that's been pointed out in both the Mobility Choice Blueprint and via AMP. Traffic camera systems, very important, and another key element of that is focusing on the interjurisdictional sharing of the views from those cameras. It's very important, so if you can see if your neighboring community has a situation that may affect your community. So within the document that's also attached is the type of evaluation criteria that's being proposed to use, and the weighting of those different criteria. You can see them here, you know, going from the key things of travel reliability and air quality benefits to the need in that geographic area. So for example, how severe is congestion in that area. Collaboration, very important. and then the objectives of both the regional transportation operations and the MetroVision key ones. So those, all of the criteria and the process is outlined in that document, which is attached. And our proposed schedule for this is actually next week, April 22nd, is a scheduled pre-application workshop. And this would be for all of the potential project applicants. And we've actually already chatted offline with several communities around the region, as well as CDOT and RTD, just to answer any questions that they might have about, you know, some of their potential projects that they might apply for. Number two there is that we're going to be asking for a letter of intent from project sponsors for each specific project that they're considering for applying. Then there'll be a review and screening of the letters of intent to determine who can submit final applications in July. Internal review panel will do an initial recommendation list in August, and then in later August and September, go through the various committees, you know, including the RTO working group, and then all of the Dr. Cog committees for final recommendation in September. So with that, I'll see if there's any questions, and the motion that's requested for the recommendation to the board of directors is up on the screen there.
Okay, Steve, it looks like we do have one hand raise. And again, this is unfortunately that setup of two people registered under the same name. So I'm just going to unmute both. And you can actually unmute yourselves. The people under Nicole Carey, one of you has your hand raised. And it looks like you're self-muted, so you might want to unmute yourself. Okay, it looks like they might be having technical difficulties. I will move on to Don Stanton for right now, and we'll come back. Don, you are able to speak. You'll just need to unmute yourself.
I have no comment. Thank you.
Okay. Okay, again, I see both hands raised. Oh, looks like one of you got unmuted. Go ahead.
Thank you very much. It's Doug Tisdale, and I think that that may be Chair Angie Rivera Malpietti, who is seeking to speak, and she may have some technical issue there with her computer, but perhaps she is speaking, and if she doesn't mind, I'll take the floor now to move to recommend to the Board of Directors the eligibility rules and evaluation process for selecting projects to be funded through the Regional Transportation Operations and Technology set aside of the 2020-2023 Transportation Improvement Program. Thank you.
Thank you, Director Tisdale, for the motion. Is there a second on the floor?
Yes, this is Andrew Rivera Malpietti. I'm so sorry, I'd like to second that motion.
Thank you, Ms. Malpietti. I appreciate the second. So we have a motion and a second. Melinda, could you unmute everybody so we can go to a voice vote, please?
Yep, everyone should be unmuted. They'll just need to remember to unmute themselves to make the motion.
Yes.
So with that.
Aye.
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 Yes.
Aye.
So we have all the ayes for yes. Are there any noes? Abstentions? Seeing that, the motion carries unanimously. Thank you so much, everybody. On to administrative items. Number seven, member comment or other matters. Are there any member comments or other matters? Please feel free to raise your hand to be recognized so we can call on you. And Melinda, please give me a report here in the next few seconds or so if there's anybody raising their hands.
All right. At this time, I am seeing no hands raised.
Great. Thank you.
This is Don Stanton. I did raise my hand.
Okay. Mr. Stanton, please. The floor is yours.
You know, I think Mayor Stoltzman really made some good comments about the unusual situation we're in. And I would urge all of us associated with Dr. Cog to look ahead 2, 3, maybe 5 years, because we're going to be in reduced circumstances. And as she said, there's potential for hyperinflation, other things. And I think we need to think outside the box and perhaps prepare for worst case. And it's very important, as Commissioner Stewart and Mayor Stoltzman said, to get money into the hands of workers for economic development as soon as we can, based on somewhat grim future. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Stanton. Is there anybody else who'd like to make comments? Okay, hearing none, the next item, the next meeting is May 19th, 2020. And at 9:28, we are adjourned. Thank you very much, everybody, for your participation. Look forward to hearing from you and hopefully seeing you next month. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yep.